So I just could see Gunjan, Anita Rani, Parul Verma, AJ Amale, Benita Kumari. Anybody else who is available for presentation? Anybody else who is available for presentation?
Dr. Sir, yes, myself, Gagan will present the, I suppose that this is in this session only, by Neha Chopra, myself and Gagan Pri.
Gagan, Yeah, so you'll be presenting, madam?
Gagan will present, Dr. Sir.
She's available?
But not the end of this session. Yes, Neha will not be, she's not well. And so Gagan is making some corrections and she'll be like towards the end of the session, she'll be ready with the presentation.
Okay. So Gagan will be there.
Yeah.
So anybody else who's available? Only 6 papers I'm finding the presenter are available here. Is anybody available from Veer San, KK Kundu or Rajkumar group? No. Anybody available from Amruta Jangale and RB Hele? No. Anybody available from Jagruti Das, Aniketa Haro or Ajmer Singh? Next paper, Varinder Shambi and Atinder Singh? No. And then last paper is Sachin Kumar, Gagandeep Banga, Babita Kumar, Palak Talwar. Anybody available?
Yes, sir. I am available, Palak Talwar.
Sir,
Palak Talwar is available.
She's available. Okay. So right now we are ready with the 7 speakers. So I think we can start with this. And if somebody will come and we can include. So, because I know that this is a new experience and first time perhaps this is a so much lengthy webinar we are proposing to be held on this webinar. So I hope that everybody should be brief because I'm sure that many people, they have internet problem, data problem and so many other problems. So not to make it a very lengthy one, let's talk briefly, and I think for Simon is 7 to. So we can simply here. He is to co-chair this session, Dr. J.M. Singh. So he's not available. Okay. So very soon, Dr. Surbhi Bansal will join us as a repeater. Because right now she's making presentation in some other session and we'll come back after presentation and we'll keep a record of our proceeding. So I think without wasting any time directly, let's come to the beginners and I simply invite Dr. Gunjan Bhandari for her presentation and the topic she's going to speak on is alternatives for accelerating agriculture growth in Uttar Pradesh. So Dr. Gunjan, are you ready?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
So we are ready to listen to your presentation.
Yeah. I'm trying to share my screen. So is it visible?
Yeah.
Okay. A very good morning, one and all. I am Gunjan Bhandari, and the title of the paper that I am going to present today is Alternatives for Accelerating Agricultural Growth in Uttar Pradesh, a zone-wise analysis. Let me get started with few key facts about Uttar Pradesh. As you all know, Uttar Pradesh is the fifth largest state of India with respect to area. And it has around 75 districts. If we talk in respect of population, then it is the most populous state of India and around 16.7% of Indian population resides in UP. It has around 70% of its total population resides in rural area, so it is having a major chunk of rural population. And again, out of total workforce, 59% of its workforce is engaged in agriculture. So this shows that rural population is predominant in UP, and most of them, as expected, are engaged in agriculture. Now, if we talk about production, then UP is a leading producer of many crops. It is leading producer of food grains, and therefore it is also called as granary of India. It leads the country in production of sugarcane, mango and potato. But if we flip the coin, on the other side, the farm households of UP, they are among the poorest in the country. Around 23% of the farm households in UP, they lie below poverty line, and their average monthly income is third lowest in the country, next only to Bihar and Uttarakhand, and their monthly income is hardly rupees 5,000. UP also has the largest share of total indebted agriculture households in India. 16.9% of indebted agriculture households, they are in UP. So this indicates that on the one side, UP has a good amount of aggregate production. At aggregate production level, it is leading, which may be only due to its big size, whereas on the other side, the agriculture growth is not at par. Now, revival of this agriculture growth is very important because a major chunk of UP depends on agriculture as a source of livelihood, and also the country, it is also important to ensure the national food security. Please request all to mute their mic. So if others can mute their mic, I think, thank you. So with this backdrop, this study was conducted to assess the performance of major drivers of agriculture growth and to identify the gaps and interventions that are required for accelerating the agriculture growth. Coming to the methodology part, as the title says, the study was conducted for UP, and the 75 districts, they were divided into four zones. These zones are the ones used by NSSO, Western, Central, Eastern and Bundelkhand area. Secondary data was used for the paper, and secondary data was collected on various aspects from different sources, like for AIY statistics, area production and I can get from statistical abstract of UP, VDSA database and Indian statistics. Then for having the frontline demonstration team, I used NFSM reports, and for data related to MSP, farm harvest price and other prices and cost of production, I used CACP data. So what I've tried in this paper, I have tried to analyze five main drivers: agricultural productivity, cropping intensity, diversification, cost, market and prices. So these are very important if you want to increase the agriculture growth. So entire data set, I have tried to analyze these drivers using that data set. I've used conventional analytical tools like percentage analysis, traffic analysis, and coefficient. Now coming to my first result, this table shows the yield of major crops. In this, I have tried to take all the important crops that are grown in UP, like paddy and wheat are the most important crops in terms of cereals. Rapeseed and mustard is important in oilseed category. Then gram is the most important pulse for UP. I've also taken total pulses separately, and then potato and sugarcane, the other two important crops in UP. So in this, we can observe that the average yield in UP is lower than the national average. And if we compare it with some state like Punjab, which is highly agriculture progressive, then UP is far, far behind. And if you look into individual zones, then Western UP, which is having almost similar agroclimatic conditions to Punjab, it is also lagging behind Punjab. And the zone like Bundelkhand, which is not having very favorable conditions, irrigation facility is not proper, rain-fed agriculture is there, and moreover, its topography is not quite favorable. So it is having the lowest yield level among all the zones. Even the pulses, which occupy around 42% of gross cropped area in Bundelkhand, it is having lowest yield in the category of pulses also. Only in the case of potato, we can see it is not lying in the lowest category. Otherwise, for all the crops, yield levels are quite low in Bundelkhand area, and UP as such, it lags behind the national level. Now coming to the table 2, in this table, what I have tried to do, I estimated the state median yield for paddy, wheat and sugarcane, and then I tried to divide the area which were having more than state median yield and the area which were having less than the state median yield. So we can see the yield is also concentrated in few pockets. Like for paddy, we can see in Western and Central UP, around 60% area, they are having more than the state median yield. But paddy is an important crop for eastern UP, but in case of eastern UP, 65% area, it is having less than the state median yield, despite paddy being their major crop. Similarly, in case of wheat, we can see in case of eastern UP, the condition is more worse. Whereas in case of western central, it is good. They are having around, western UP is having around 90% area, which is having more than the state median yield. In case of sugarcane also, eastern UP is not faring well. So this shows that we need to do something about eastern UP. We have to diversify the agriculture. We have to move out from this paddy wheat system. Now coming to table 3, in this I took the means if we compare the state with other states, then we have seen that there is lower level of yield. But if we compare the average yield of the state with its frontline demonstration yield, in that category also we can see the yield gap in UP is higher than the national yield gap. So this is also a cause of concern. And among all the zones, Bundelkhand, as expected, it is having the highest yield gap for all the crops. Now coming to coefficient of variation of yield of rice, wheat and pulses, as you've already discussed, lower yield are a cause of concern. So if we increase the yield levels in UP, which is very much possible because there is a big yield gap, then it can lead to more agricultural growth. Now if we talk about yield risk, we can observe the CV, the coefficient of variation, which basically reflects the fluctuations in the yield level. So here also we can see, in case of Bundelkhand, the CV is very high for all the crops, paddy wheat and even for pulses. So in case of Bundelkhand, we need to ensure that the farmers get good insurance facilities and all, so that they are encouraged to go for agriculture. If they will get some form of security, then they will be encouraged to go for agriculture. Shows cropping intensity. Besides increasing the yield, reducing the yield gap, the another thing that we can do is to improve the cropping intensity. So over the years, we can notice that cropping intensity has increased in UP. And basically, in Uttarakhand, in Bundelkhand, the increase has been quite significant. But again, if you compare with Punjab, the cropping intensity is lower for UP as a whole. And if we compare it with India, then it is higher. So again, here, in this case, what we can do, we can introduce shorter duration variety of sugarcane. Sugarcane is an important crop in UP. So if we go for shorter duration variety of sugarcane, then we can take one additional crop and we can increase the cropping intensity, which will ultimately lead to increase in agricultural growth. This table shows the share of area under non-cereal crops in gross cropped area. So what I have done from the total area, I have taken the share of non-cereal crops. So in this we can see the share of area under non-cereal crops is highest in case of Bundelkhand. This is basically because they are growing pulses. But this area is not increasing, or means there is not much change in this area over the years. In case of eastern UP, we can see it to sway system to more diversified system, but opposite is happening. Of area crops is decreasing, that means the share of area under cereal crops is increasing. That shouldn't be there. Now, this table shows the percentage share of area of different crops in area under non-cereal crops. So in this we can see basically the area under pulses is declining over the years, whereas area under sugarcane is increasing, particularly in central zone and eastern zone, whereas the share of area under fruits and vegetables is almost stagnant over the year. So this is one area which we can give basis, because fruits and vegetables are high value commodity and our yield is not having good yield levels in case of paddy and all. They are a good producer of banana. Banana is produced in eastern zone. Then mango is also an important crop in UP. So we can give emphasis on diversifying the cropping system, and we can include more and more fruits and vegetables so that agriculture growth can be short and income of the agriculture households can be increased. If we talk about cost and net returns, then again we can see in the case of paddy, the cost of UP is higher than that of Punjab. And in case of wheat, it is higher than all other states. It is high even if you compare it with Bihar. The cost of production of wheat is higher in UP. But if we talk about net returns, then the net returns are lowest in UP in case of wheat. And this is basically because of high cost of seed. I found in CCP data that wheat is costly in UP. Then again, irrigation cost is quite high in UP. So we can do something about that so that cost of production will be reduced, and if yield level will improve, then definitely our net returns will also improve. Coming to zone-wise average cost of cultivation, Western UP is having the highest cost of cultivation and net returns are also high in this zone, whereas Bundelkhand is having the least cost of production and net returns are also lower in this zone. Now, if you look at the top 10 producing districts of the state, then you can see paddy is basically concentrated in the eastern area. Wheat is basically concentrated in western and central UP. Sugarcane is concentrated again in western area, and potato is also a major crop of western UP. So what we can do, we can identify such pockets for all the crops, and we can develop infrastructure, area specific infrastructure in all the zones. Like potato is a major crop of western UP, so we can create more and more cold storage facilities in this particular region of UP. So this can one more initiative which will help to accelerate the growth of agriculture. If you compare the farm harvest price versus minimum support price, see, UP is a leading producer of cereals. It is producing paddy, it is producing wheat. It is one of the top producer of these crops. But if you compare the farm harvest price with MSP, minimum support price, then we can observe barely, except few years, farm harvest price is even lower than the minimum support price. So if the farmers are not able to get even the minimum support price, so there is no question that their income will increase. So again, if you look at the procurement levels, hardly 10% of the total production of paddy and wheat is being procured in UP. So something needs to be done about the procurement system also. And we need to ensure that farmers should at least get minimum support price. If they are not able to get more than that, they should be able to get at least minimum support price for the major crops. Coming to the policy implication part, so if you want to improve the agriculture growth in UP, we need to reduce the yield gap and we need to increase the coverage of horticulture crop. We can introduce shorter duration varieties of sugarcane. We can invest more in irrigation. Like around 85% of the irrigation in UP is being done by diesel operated pumps. So we can replace those diesel operated pumps with electric pumps or solar pumps, and it will reduce the cost of production. Revamped extension services are also required because extension reach is very poor in UP. As NSSO data says, around only 50% of farmers, they are having access to technical advice. Then in Bundelkhand zone, awareness is required regarding crop insurance and other risk minimization strategies like crop diversification. We need to strengthen the procurement system in whole UP, in the entire state. More crop diversification is required in case of eastern UP. And area-specific incentives like cold storage for potato is required. Means such kind of initiatives can be done for other crops also. So these things can be done in order to ensure higher agriculture growth. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It was really a nice presentation. Actually, we keep the discussion at the end of the presentations, as Dr. Gunjan Bhandari is leaving this group to join some other group to work as a rapporteur. So I would like, if somebody has some question, they can ask some questions to Dr. Gunjan on her presentation. And I have two or three queries from Dr. Gunjan. If you permit me, I can start the discussion, and later on the participants who are interested to have clarified their queries from Dr. Gunjan, they can do it. So really, Gunjan, it was a nice presentation, but I saw that you are comparing two uncomparable things. For example, you are comparing the yield of paddy and of Punjab with UP as a whole, which is very, because that is more close to the agroclimatic and cropping situation of the Punjab. So when you are comparing two uncomparable things, suddenly you will say that the productivity level in UP is lower.
Yes, sir.
Just listen one more thing. And you also rightly pointed out that over the years, the area under pulses is declining. Okay. So what actually we need to do to further strengthen the area under pulses? And my third and last query is, you said that with regard to paddy and wheat, very little amount, 10 to 20% is being put the government on FP. Right? You think that the government government is liberalizing the trade. Do you think that you suggest a well government to purchase at the? I have two, three queries, and you can answer, and then one they can ask the question. Thank you.
Okay, so regarding your first, like when UP is more similar to Punjab, we can't compare like Bundelkhand, Central, and East. I agree with that. So what I think, I tried to do those zones, and then I also tried comparing them with the state average frontline demonstration yield. So in order to address that point, I tried comparing the yield of those zones with the frontline demonstration yield, and using that, I have calculated the yield gap. Because I agree, I can't compare Central zone and Bundelkhand zone with Punjab. So I kept Punjab there only to compare it with Western zone. And so regarding second question, like pulses, I was not able to get the correct explanation, correct reason for this thing, because pulses are fetching good price. They are getting, means the farm harvest price is higher than MSP for pulses. But still farmers are not interested, maybe, but yield fluctuations are very high in case of pulses, maybe due to that, but I was not able to get a correct reason for this thing. And regarding the procurement, yeah, I agree. I don't know. It's going to be a hard time for farmers in the future, because right now also they are being exploited by the traders. They are not able to sell it to the procurement centers also. But if you are going to liberalize the agriculture, then traders, they might get an upper hand. Until unless the farmers are empowered enough, like by creating more and more farmer-producer societies, through that way they can ensure that they can get prices in the market. Otherwise, I don't think there is much scope that they can get good prices if this procurement system will be dismantled.
Thank you. Sir. Anybody have any question to Dr. Gunjan?
James Singh. Hello?
Thank you, sir.
Hello, I'm Dr. James Singh.
Yes.
Dr. James Singh, you have joined?
Yes, sir. I want to ask her a question that
she
said before. Are you able to listen to me?
Thank you, sir. I'm able to listen.
I want to ask a question that you have said that cost of production is high in UP. That is that part of your study you have conducted. And the net returns also are high. How is it possible as compared to Punjab, net returns are also
high? No, sir. Cost of production. Net returns are lowest in UP.
No, you have said, I think, I don't know, but I've heard that you said cost of production is high.
Net so maybe by mistake, but
they are not getting the at MSP, the how the returns can
so be. So it is not high. Maybe by mistake I might have said, but in table it is lowest. For you, maybe it is lowest, even lower than Bihar.
I have just heard only that. Second, you said about the sugarcane variety, which is that variety which... Because mostly varieties are long duration varieties are there. Sugarcane is a crop that is being grown for a whole of year or something.
So
that only is for 2-3 years also.
Yes, I do not exactly remember the name. Sorry, but I have heard about two varieties that they have released. They are short duration varieties, and in Central UP they have started growing some of the farmers. I'm very sorry, I didn't remember the name.
I want to say that is very good, because otherwise sugarcane, that is we can say water department sugarcane is more as compared to paddy plus wheat. So that would be good. That is why you want to ask you that which is variety that variety is.
Sorry, sir, I don't remember the name.
And I want to congratulate you that actually your presenters are very good. Was good. Always there are some questions always there. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. JM. Thank you. Very nice question. Anybody else? Any other question from the participants, Dr. Gunjan? So I think there's no question. So thank you very much, Dr. Gunjan Pandari.
Yes.
You have touched good points and your presentation was very good. I congratulate. And now I think you'll be going to do your another duty in some other session.
Yes, sir. So with your permission. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, Gunjan. So in the series now, our second paper, which is scheduled for his presentation here, is Socioeconomic Profile of Labor Households in Rural Punjab, to be presented by Dr. Anita Rani. Right?
Yes, she's here. Sir, I'm here.
Okay. Welcome. And okay. Okay, you can start with your presentation.
Okay. I am sharing my screen. Good morning, everyone. My topic is socioeconomic profile of labor households in rural Punjab. Sir, I am audible. Introduction: the population of rural laborers in Punjab is growing at a very increasing rate due to failure of farming, loss of land by farmers to repay old debt, subdivision of land, and decline of handicraft industries. But the simultaneous and massive use of labor saving techniques like mechanization of farm operations, use of herbicides, and harvesting combines has gradually reduced the power of agriculture to absorb human labor. This has created the problem of unemployment and underemployment for rural labor. The basic reasons behind labor socioeconomic conditions of the labor are illiteracy, lack of skills, and income generating assets, landlessness due to failure of land reform, and poor execution of the welfare scheme. Objectives of the study.
Dr. Anita, sorry for disruption.
Hello.
Can you increase the size of your slide if possible?
Yes, sir.
If you can increase the size of the slide because it's not readable. And moreover, I also suggest to you, if you are using your mic, be in that or speak loudly. Please
okay,
speak
sir.
Loudly.
Now,
thank you.
Objective of the study. Hello.
Okay, participants.
Okay, sir. Objective of the study. The present paper is an attempt to analyze the socioeconomic profile of labor households in rural Punjab, which covers the parameters such as age, caste, family type, type of house, education, etc. Research methodology. The present paper is based on primary sources of data for the purpose of data collection. Multi-state random sampling was three zones, medium and high productivity zone. Zone from productivity zone and Lubang high productivity zone was selected on random basis. One central labor village, the household results and discussion. Distribution of rural labor households. Table 1, majority of rural labor households belong to scheduled caste. The scheduled caste category consists of 87.74% of the sampled rural labor households, 86.90% of the agricultural labor households, and 88.38% of the non-agricultural labor households. The general category and backward class constitutes the very low household percentage, like 8.11% household represent the backward class category and 4.15% household represent the general class category. Thus, most of the household representing the scheduled caste category, thus give are a suppressed class and cannot fight for their rights. Taking family type and family size of the rural labor household. The table showed that the average family size of the agriculture and non-agricultural labor households were 5.12 and 5.23. As far as the distribution of sampled rural labor households according to family size was concerned, it was found that 46.42% of the total rural labor households had declared family, while the remaining 53.58% had joint family. Similar trends were noticed to the categories agricultural labor households and non-agricultural labor households. This table shows that most of the rural labor households belong to joint family system. Housing condition of the rural labor household. Table 3 exhibited that majority of the rural labor households are living in semi-paka houses. That is 54.53% rural labor households are living in semi-paka houses, while 52.40% agriculture labor households and 56.15% non-agriculture labor households are also living in semi-paka houses. Further, the table shows that around 96.79% of rural labor households, 95.63% agriculture labor households and 97.67% non-agricultural labor households have toilet facilities in their houses because of government schemes. Further, if we look at the housing condition, the rural labor, most of the rural labor had on the houses of average condition. Almost 54.72% of rural labor had on the houses of average condition, while 2.49% of non-agricultural labor households, non-agricultural labor households are also living in average condition households. Further, the main source of drinking water for rural labor was public as 75.11% agricultural labor and 78.1% labor household. If we see the distribution of sampled rural labor population on the basis of educational status, we saw that as many as 20.35% of the sampled rural labor house population were illiterate, while 21.15% of agricultural labor population and 19.75% non-agricultural labor population were illiterate. Among the illiterates, 30.58% of rural labor population were educated up to primary level, 22.77% population were educated up to middle level, 17.85% population are educated up to matric level, 7.46% population are educated up to high secondary level, and 0.99% population are educated up to graduation level. The above analysis showed that very few persons from sampled labor households got education above matric level. Due to this, they were not able to get jobs with higher earning. The success ratio for rural labor households were 891, agricultural labor households were 895, and non-agricultural labor households were 3AA. Next is why. Age-wise distribution of rural labor. Table 5 showed that 23.33% of the rural labor population were below 30 years age, 26-7 population were belong to 30-45% years population group, 15.17% population belong to 45-60 years age group. On the other hand, the population of the rural population is 4 to 15 years, majority of population were 14 age group. And also noticed in case of agriculture and non-agricultural labor category, economic status of the rural labor household. The table 6.07% were belong to dependent category, 21.18% were belong to earning dependent category, and 32.7% were belong to earner category. In case of the agricultural labor household, 30.01 belonging to earning category, 27.79 belonging to earning dependent category, and 42.20 belonging to dependent category. For non-agricultural labor households, 34.80 were belonging to category, 16.25 were belonging to earning dependent category, and 48.95% were belonging to dependent category. The analysis revealed that ratio of dependents were higher among rural labor households due to less employment opportunities in the rural area. Conclusion and policy implication. The above analysis clearly indicate that majority of the sampled rural labor households belong to scheduled caste. The analysis also showed that rural labor has minimum access to various facilities like good housing, education, safe drinking water, which required urgent attention, in order to improve the socio-economic conditions of rural laborers in Punjab, government and its institutions have to come up with effective policies. The program like Sar Shiksha Abhiyan should be implemented on priority basis. So the government has provided some kind of scholarship to increase the attainment of education, but the lack of professional knowledge and financial constraints become hindrance in acquiring higher end professional education. So government must provide skill-based professional education to the wards of these poor labor households. Apart from this, easy and cheap institutional finance for education should be given top priority. The government must come forward in providing housing facilities to rural labors. Gram Panchayat should provide fresh drinking water by setting up journal taps and water filters in rural areas for these labor households. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Anita, for nice presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
And I think now the question, the discussion session will keep at the end of this. And anybody who has some query or question from Dr. Anita, they can simply note down. And in the end, we'll spend 10-15 minutes for the discussion. And in the series now, I invite the next speaker, Parul Verma, for her presentation on very interesting topic, Farmer Sustainability and Social Justice, Evidences from Land Inequalities in UP. So Parul, you are ready?
Yes, sir, I'm ready.
Okay, thank you.
A very good morning, Chairperson, and my dear intellectual friends. Today, here I am going to present a paper entitled, as sir mentioned, The Sustainable Development Goal, SDG, basically the main number 2, which is aimed to end the hunger, achieve, promote the sustainable, recognizes the interlinkages among the sustainable agriculture methods via empowering small and marginal farmers, promoting equality, enduring, ending the rural poverty with the assurance of the healthy life standard, and which leads to the better standard of living. Therefore, sustainable development goal that is associated with the agricultural development, we can say that it may lead to the farmer sustainability. But while coming to the social justice, the justice demands that all people have equal distribution to resources, and this includes the employment equality for farmers, farm workers, laborers, and other employed in that same system. So the sustainability is not only the question of economic viability and environmental integrity, but sustainability is a question of social justice too. Therefore, the social justice and sustainable development are the two tenses of the knife that necessary, or you can say highly essential, for effective and all-inclusive sustainable agricultural development. For framing the paper and conducting the study, mainly the John Eichert and Clancy Clora paper has been taken as a major worthy review for the paper. And the aim present study aims to evaluate the farmer sustainability and social justice among the farmers in terms of land fragmentation index. That's why I have computed a land fragmentation index, and further I have analyzed the farmers' distress also. The study is mainly grounded on the field survey of Uttar Pradesh, and the method for collecting the data has been used, that is the multi-stage random sampling method. The total sample size is 320. Sampling design mentioned in the slide, and as we know that Uttar Pradesh is basically divided into 4 main regions, Eastern, Central, Bundelkhand, and Western. Therefore, in the same hierarchy, by following the multi-stage random sampling, one district and one block, then one village taken, city samples from index, sign fragmentation index, even has been in the paper implementation, which is the situation in the distress and they are not able or they are not willing to continue that occupation, if they will get some better opportunity, they are ready to postpone this. Whether recently UP farmers, as per the surveyed area, whether they want to continue this occupation in future or not, so their willingness has been calculated. And for the distress of the farmers, the approach that has been considered in the paper is taken from the working paper of Sardar Singh Johal, the working paper published and just available at the website of RBI. Approach has been taken here. Now coming to the analytical part. So here mainly whether the farmers are distressed and that is reflecting in terms of the willingness to continue the occupation. So it shows from the slide that Sitwali village, that is the second village, it shows the highest percent of the farmers who are not willing to continue farming, and that is further followed by the Chersoni village, Jansar and Jonai. Now that is fine that they are distressed and they don't want to continue or something, there is a reason, that's why they are hesitating to pursue that occupation in future further. So what may be the possible reason? It has been investigated and it has been found that they be focused on the reason to continuing it mainly that they are having the less opportunity within the agriculture, because in the surveyed area, mostly in these villages, first three villages, the farmers I have found, they are the marginal small farmers. So farmers are reporting that there are mainly less opportunity within the agriculture sector for first three villages, that's why they are not willing to continue it in further. But the Joni village is the village where at least 32.5 farmers are reporting that they are earning the satisfactory income and they will go for it. Village is basically from the western region, and so far there from this village I have gained some semi-medium and medium farmers. So that is maybe the reason that they are getting a satisfactory income, because and earning from it. But reason not continuing here, it is persisted. Majority of the farmers from all the chosen village respond that agriculture is not providing them a regular source of income. So basically, an issue of the irregularity is persisting on farming in future if they will get any other option go. And on the flip side of it, some farmers perceive agriculture as a sluggish job because it requires a lot of labor and physical efforts, and in return, what they are getting is just a little reward. Here, the sustainability and unsustainability rate of this occupation, as per the farm size wise, has been calculated, and it is showing that medium farms has the relatively higher sustainability, followed by semi-medium, marginal, and small category of farms. Now coming to the farm wise land fragmentation index, and it shows that when it comes to the marginal and small farms. In case of marginal farms, land fragmentation index has been detected a low, and the reason is because they have a very tiny piece of land. So for that, the land fragmentation index value detection cannot get so high. But as we move to the second category of farms, that is small farms, and as the farm size just get double of it, we can able to see that medium range of index and high range of index, under that two ranges, more farms has been recorded. In case of semi-medium farms, 50% of the farms, this group lying under the medium range of index, followed by the high and low range of index. And for the lastly, the medium category of farms, fourth one, it shows that the majority of the farms lying under the low range of index, followed by the medium and high category of the high range of index, basically. The reason behind that for the medium group farms, because they are relatively lesser, having a lesser absolute number of parcels. So the number of parcels for the medium category of farms are the lesser as compared to earlier ones. So that is the possible reason that medium farms are not detected for the high range of index. but the inequality and unevenness is still persisting in Uttar Pradesh. Now coming to the farm-wise distribution of the fragmented land issues, and here the question basically, as we don't get the value of fragmentation index 1, which shows that there is no case of fragmentation, there is a case of the fragmentation. It means that under all the classes of the fragmentation eventually persisting. Now coming to this slide, as shows that I have asked the questions and the responded responses have been recorded, that whether they have the problem or the this is as the normal responding that they have with the fragment for the respective classes semi medium and M to space if would be fine and farmers will also participate. In the analysis that farms are distressed due to certain mentioned reasons. Land fragmentation index doesn't reveal the value of one also. And the fragmentation is associated with the negative aspects such as hindering the mechanism of the mechanization, technical farm support access, inefficient production, and ineffectiveness of the cost. Therefore, the economies of scale is not possible to achieve for the for especially in case of marginal and small farmers. So therefore, as we know that the land is the prime factor for agriculture, and its unequal and diminutive distribution wouldn't lead to the social equality justice in the continuing going scenario, particularly in Uttar Pradesh. Therefore, the two core principal suggestions I would like to, as I have considered and presenting here, the consolidation of the land holding is a viable solution to wipe out the stumbling block of the diminutive land holding, as per the fragmentation is continuing growing phenomena in various states. So it is required to revisit it. The same performer cannot be applied or exercised at the present time. That's why I'm emphasizing on the revisiting of the consolidation performer as it was exercised in the 1970s. So it strongly required the revisiting or re-examination. Secondly, a suitable farming system that allows large scale of operation with the collectivization of the approach that should be initiated with the appropriate governance and the strong mechanism it will further help in mitigating the ill effect of the fragmented land holdings and ultimately and eventually helping our marginal and small farmers. As we know, the Uttar Pradesh is majoritized with the marginal and small farmers mainly, because 79-80% of the farmers are marginal and small farmers. These remedial measures may lead to the social justice and farmer sustainability for their occupation and their self-interest in the same. Thank you. Thank you for hearing with the patience. Thank you, sir.
Hello. Thank you. Thank you very much, Parin, for your presentation. Nice presentation.
Sir.
Can you remove your...
Hello?
Hello. Sir.
Hello.
Just a minute.
Can I ask her question, one question or so?
Okay, but if we ask at the end, that will be not better. But still, you ask some question, you can ask. Go ahead.
No, that we can ask in the end also.
You can just go ahead if you have some important query. Then.
So actually, I want to ask her that everyone is saying that farmers are not willing to continue farming. There are less opportunities, sluggish job, so and so on. So many things are there. So then where they are going to, what they are going to do in future then? If everybody is saying, mostly they are saying that it's not, I think the opportunities are less, sluggish job is there. So then how we can stop the farmers from because of fragmentation when everybody, every farmer, that is a right, that when there are two sons in a family, everybody that is going to be divided. Then how they are going to work together when there are some differences are always there? Because everybody, because farmer think that this land is their mother. So how is going to happen that they can consolidate? And then, so I am not unable to understand if she can tell something, put some light on this issue.
Okay, Parul, if you have some answers, you can share with us.
Yes, sir, I agree with this. Yeah, exactly, you are pointing out the right problem, that number of farmers has been increasing and fragmentation is like in hierarchy it is going on. But think about it, like Operation Burga in a West Bengal, and even in the Punjab, we have relatively lesser number of marginal and small farms. So are they not able to produce collectively? If the collective approach we are following, so it will not going to harm the farmers as well as the land also. And as you are saying, the farmers are treating the land as a mother, and they are treating it as their mother. But when the pressure of compression of the population is continuously increasing, so is it not the a natural and existing phenomena that land will somewhere the land will not be exactly raising in the same ratio as the population has been raising? So there is a need to raise some other alternative opportunities for their occupational activities. That is the urgent need for it. And just skilling the farmers or MG Narega is a good option, but what extent I'm not able to say that. But there is a urgent need to simultaneously giving them the skills, as well as that skill should be applicable somewhere at which they can able to get the earning. Because ultimately for the poor person and for the poor rural populace, what is highly significant and important, that is the earning. They are doing every work for the earning. So if they will able to get the earning, so it will be fine. But as per the land is not of this much size, and when the land is lesser, so we can understand that we cannot raise a very drastically, we cannot raise the productivity also. So what is the alternatives available? We will have to raise the occupational opportunity, others like small and cottage industry, and there are various opportunities for them. But the policymaker should have to be very following. They should have to follow the high governance, and implementation body should be very transparent and reflective. That should reflect the problem of the farmers or the basic ground.
Okay. Actually, what is there that their income from farming should also increase at the same time. Besides, we can say
if they will get some other opportunities, so definitely the disguised unemployment issue will be mitigating from the agriculture, and they can switch towards the other issue, other occupational opportunity. So like we know that in Uttar Pradesh also the women are coming to the participating in the cultivation, and this is the scenario that we are facing, that women are holding the agriculture purely, and the male person from the rural populace are going outside and earning. So they are balancing their earning as well, and the earning from the agriculture also they are gaining. They are able to think for it simultaneously. At the same time, they are earning from other sources. So they cannot rely totally upon agriculture, specifically as per the concern of the marginal and small farmers.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a good discussion, and there are, it's a very, very debatable issue actually,
Yes, sir.
Because Parul already said that farmers, they feel that this is agriculture is sluggish. So this in the sense that they don't have regular income. But if farmers, they go for seasonal crop, one in Kharif and one in Rabi, how they can earn their income regularly? To make their income regularly, they have to go for some other crops, like vegetables, other things, they can increase their income, they can earn the money regular on weekly basis or monthly basis. They can also start some milk production, animal husbandry, that will give them the... So all these issues, that is also with the farmer. It's not only the agriculture has become sluggish, rather I would say that the farmers themselves have become sluggish. They don't want to actively involve in agriculture, so that they adopt such ventures which give them regular income. So that is the issue, you know, with the farmer also. They are also very comfortable that grow this and sell it. And that is why. And moreover, yeah, of course, that some farmer I normally say that they should go out of the agriculture sector provided some non-farm activities are developed. So if they can get alternative employment in non-agriculture sector, that will also help improving their income. So I think we have already taken quite a good discussion on Parul Verma's paper. So thank you very much. And now we start with the other presentation. So our next presenter was Dr. A.J. Amarle. And the topic he'll be presenting, sustainable development through the soil and water conservation work, a case study of village Gatisiraj, Ahmednagar, Maharashtra. So paper is more on conservation of agriculture input or agriculture resources. So now I invite Dr. Amarle to start with your presentation. Dr. Surbhi Bansal, welcome. You have joined us.
Yes, sir.
You have joined us. Welcome. Welcome, yes, as a deputy.
Thank you, sir. You
write down some important points which will be required for preparing the proceeding of this meeting, right?
Okay, sir.
So, Dr. Amarle, are you ready? Dr. Amarle, are you ready?
Is he there?
Dr. Amarle? I think we have lost connection with him. Everybody else is audible? Hello? Just say hi, everyone. I just want to say hello.
Hello, sir. You are audible. Perfectly audible.
So, Dr. Amarle is not listening to me. So I think due to some technical problem, he has lost their connection. And then we can, for the time being, we can just forward with our next presentation by Dr. Vinita Kumari. And the topic she'll be speaking on is profit efficiency of women dairy farmers in Begusarai district of Bihar. So Dr. Vinita Kumari, you can start with your presentation. I think Dr. Amarle has come. Dr. Vinita, do you listen to me?
Yes, sir.
You can start with your presentation.
I'm sharing my screen. Good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. And if you can just speak a bit loudly, that will be even convenient.
Myself, Vinita Kumari, I'm going to present on the topic profit efficiency of women dairy farmers in Begusarai district of Bihar. Women, they have always been a key stakeholder in dairy farming, but they are never given a status of a dairy farmer and they are never involved in any decision making related to dairy farming practices. So government has started many programs so as to give them the status of a women dairy farmer. So few of the programs are like cooperative development program, women's cooperative dairy cooperative leadership development program, and support to training and employment program. This study, it involves the support to training and employment program. It was launched in 1986 and its main purpose was to ensure the well-being of women in traditional informal sectors of dairy. It is sponsored by the Department of Women and Child Development, Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India, and it aims at increasing the self-reliance and autonomy of women in enhancing their productivity and enabling them to take up income generation activities. Under this program, women dairy cooperative societies were established. Now, the current study is taken in the Bekusarai district of Bihar, and women dairy cooperative societies were established under the project, the Bihar Women Dairy Project, which was implemented by Bihar State Cooperative Milk Producers Federation Limited. Under this project, women dairy cooperative societies were started, and only women can be members of these cooperative societies, and all the work, right? From cattle rearing to record keeping, everything is done by the women members. They are also encouraged to take up, learn artificial insemination and other technical things. So the current study, it involves finding out how these women dairy cooperative societies are influencing the profit efficiency of the women dairy farmers. Coming to the sampling plan, the state Bihar was selected because it was one of the few pioneers where the women dairy cooperative societies were started. Now, there are 6 milk unions in Bihar, and among which the Desh Ratna Rajendra Prasad Milk Union Baroni was selected because its procurement is highest among all the 6 milk unions. The districts, there are 4 districts which are covered under this particular milk union, among which Bekusarai district was chosen because it had the highest number of functional women dairy cooperative societies. From this district, 4 blocks were selected on the basis of the highest number of women dairy cooperative societies, and from each block, 2 villages each were selected. And from these 8 villages, combinedly 80 members and 80 non-members dairy farmers, women dairy farmers, were selected randomly. Now coming to what is profit efficiency? It is defined as the capability of the farm to achieve the highest possible profit given the prices and levels of fixed factors at the farm. For this study, the stochastic transfer profit function model was used to estimate the efficiency.
Hello. Hello, Dr. Brita, is there a problem?
It's not audible.
Dr. Brita, are you available?
It's not audible. It's not audible.
She's not available, I think.
She has also shared her screen also, Anna.
She is not able to listen us even.
So there, I think some network issue should be there. I think.
There could be many issues. It's a new system. So. Dr. Benita, I think she has lost her connection. So what should we do then? We should forward.
Should we go for the next presentation, sir?
Yeah, I think so. So I think if she come back in some time, we'll give her another chance. But with this, we can just move on to the next presentation. So now I have to see that who are the people available for the presentation. Can anybody introduce that those are available? Dr. Amale, do you have any problem?
Yes. No, sir.
Are you ready for presentation now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay then. You can start with your presentation.
Yeah, I'm sharing my screen, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, of course. This is your screen?
Yes, sir. It's going on, sir.
Your screen look like Corona. It is very, very, you know, be careful of this.
Sir, is screen shared by me? It's visible. Sir, it's visible.
No, your screen is not available. I am seeing just my own photo. Your screen is not. Yeah, your you just start with
your visible, sir, now.
Yeah, it's coming. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, now it's coming. You can start with your presentation.
Yes, sir. I am Dr. Arun Amle from MPK. I'm here to share my paper on the sustainable development through soil and water conservation work. This is the case study of one of the village ghat shearers from the Maharashtra. Now the background is this. This is the flagship program of Maharashtra government, which is launched in 2015-16 with the aim of to make 5,000 villages free of water scarcity every year. And this program is taken with the aim to establish aim with a belief in a farmer that every drop of water. And we have evaluated the impact of such a program with the well-defined objectives to evaluate the targets and achievements of different activities under this Jal Yukt Shivar Abhiyan. Second, to study the changes in land use and cropping pattern, changes in input use and productivities of the different crops. Fourth one, to evaluate the changes in livestock economy of beneficiaries due to the impact of these soil and conservation work. And last one, study the change in employment, income, and expenditure of pattern of. Likewise.
Dr. Malia, sometimes you are audible, sometimes you are
this,
not.
This project, this research project is.
I think you need
Ahmednagar district from the western mind. Maharashtra was purposely selected because situated in the scarcity zone of the Maharashtra. Now it is audible, sir.
Yes,
Pathardi Tehsil from the Ahmednagar district are chosen on the basis of highest number of villages selected in this Jal Yukt Shivar. Village ghat shearers are selected randomly.
Mm-hmm. I think you might have some internet problem. Hello. Hello. Hello, Male. Hello.
I think उनका फोन हैंग हो गया।
उनका फोन हैंग हो गया?
सर, क्योंकि वो उनकी सारी प्रेजेंटेशन रुक गई है इन मिडल। और विनीता कुमारी सर बैक है, फिर आ गए हैं। तो विनीता कुमारी मैम आ गए हैं।
तो अब क्या करें, इनको फिर रुके भी हमारे? Is he listening to me or not?
I don't think so. He is listening to us.
So, can we discontinue with this presentation and start with the Dr. Benita? She's back?
Sure, sir.
Yeah, okay, you can start with the. So, Dominita, you can start. So, Dominita, we are waiting for you.
Actually, I'm not able to share the screen because sir's previous presentation is already being shared.
So, can you speak just now if you have some alternative? If you have presentation with you, you can just speak on.
Amle.
Male is not, I think, his screen is also always shared and no screen is now can be shared.
He is not able to hear us also, I think, na?
Yeah, he has lost his connection. His computer has got stuck in between. Now we have only alternative. Dr. Benita, you can just go with your presentation without sharing your screen, please.
Okay, sir. I'll continue from where I left. Yes, sir. The profit efficiency model was estimated by using the method of maximum likelihood. And for that, the profiteer 4.1 application was being used. The inefficiency model was estimated, and the explanatory variables for that were age of the farmer, farming experience, training undertaken, herd size, herd composition, and family size capable of working. The herd composition, here we mean that what is the ratio of crossbred to the total herd. Now, coming to the results, the summary statistics of the descriptive variables, the profit for the members was, the mean profit was 1,103.25 rupees per month, whereas for non-members it was 803.37. The output price of milk was higher in case of non-members, 27.97 rupees per liter, and for for members it was 26.46 rupees. The herd size for members was 5.05 animals, and for non-members it was 4.61 animals. Coming to the herd composition, it was nearly same for both members and non-members at 0.83 and 0.85 for members and non-members respectively. Coming to the maximum, the prices, the normalized prices of bean fodder, normalized prices of dry fodder had negative and significant impact on the profit, whereas the the herd size had significant and positive impact on the profits of both members and non-member dairy farmers. Whereas in case of non-members, the prices of bean fodder and concentrate had a significant and negative impact. Coming to the various parameters, the sigma square component, which represents the goodness of fit of the function, it was significant in case of both members and non-members, showing that the function is a good fit. The value of gamma, which ranges from 0 to 1, which shows whether inefficiency exists or not. If it is close to 0, means close to 1 means high inefficiency is there, and close to 0 means inefficiencies are less. In case of members, the inefficiency was 89.48, which means that the value of gamma was 89.48, which means that the inefficiency is there. It is close to 1. In case of non-members, it is higher, that is 0.9267. And it also shows that 89.48% of the changes, variation in the actual mean value, mean profit from the highest level of profit, farmers' efficiency. In case of members, the farming size, farming experience, training undertaken, herd size and herd composition had a negative and significant impact, which means that if farming experience, training, herd size and herd composition is increased, then profit inefficiency will decrease, which means efficiency will increase. In case of non-members, training undertaken, herd size, herd composition had a negative and significant impact. Coming to the frequency distribution of profit efficiency of dairy farmers according to different herd size categories, it can be seen that in case of member, the mean profit efficiency was 71.76%, whereas it was lower in case of non-members, that is 60.77%. In case of members, as the profit efficiency is 71.76%, it means that about 29% of the efficiency can be increased if the allocative and technical inefficiencies are decreased. Whereas in case of non-members, about 40% of the inefficiencies can be decreased by taking care of the allocative and technical inefficiencies. Coming to the conclusions, the study reflected that the profit efficiency of women dairy farmers was about 11% more than that of the women non-member dairy farmers. The mean efficiency in case of member and non-member farmers is 71.76% and 60.77% respectively, which means that about 28.24% and 39.23% of profit can be increased by improving technical and allocative inefficiency. Efficiencies. The major determinants of profit inefficiencies were found to be age of the women dairy farmers, training received by them, farming experience, herd size, herd composition, etc. Also, the members received about 37% more profits when compared to that of non-members. Thus, the study concludes that WDCS have been instrumental in changing the overall dairy paradigm in rural India, alongside bringing about feminization in agriculture. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nadita Kumari. You have to go without your screen sharing. Anyway, still you did very good. So, any question, Dr. Jain, you want to ask?
Actually, sir, I want to ask her which is a major factor in increasing property efficiency of the members, actually. This is one of the major factors she can tell.
Herd size, in this case. Herd size is a major factor.
Herd size. Yeah. Besides herd size, there can be also, I think, they may be using concentrates.
Prices are also.
Or they must have taken some training also.
Yeah, sir.
Herd size is also important.
Yeah, herd size is important, and those other factors were also included in the fodder. Prices of the dry fodder, green fodder, concentrate, labor, herd size, etc.
They are going for AI or not, that is also very important, I think.
Yeah, that too is important, but sir, that has not been included.
Okay, thank you.
Anybody else want to ask any question?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Pavel, go ahead.
Ma'am, as you mentioned that family size of capable of working is not taken as one variable. So is it the absolute family size or you have scaling something for taking or measuring the capability?
adults were taken into view, because total family size includes children also, but they are not capable of working. Only those above 18 years were included.
They are coming at the capital of working.
Yeah.
Okay. And for the profit inefficiency, what are the inefficiency factors you have chosen?
What factors that affect the inefficiency? Age of the farmer was chosen, then the herd composition, herd size. Herd composition, it includes what is the ratio of crossbred to total herd. Then training received by them, whether they receive training or not.
Six factors
are there. Total of six factors.
Inefficiency, these are the major.
Yeah, farming experience, family size.
The optimum in
my search was 3 point something, about 3 animals.
And what do you think? How much is the herd size should be there to maximize the profit efficiency?
I have done one more study in that which I maximize the profits using the Shure model. And if according to that study, at least 4 should be the standard animal units, so that farmer gets the profits, so that their profits is maximized according to the whatever their cost is there.
So just 4. And you are
in eastern regions. I am talking about eastern region, which included states of in the study area.
I am just asking, based on your study, because one of your policy suggestion you made that to increase the profit efficiency, herd size should be increased.
Yeah.
So that is why my simple query is, what is the optimum herd size and what is the present herd size? I couldn't listen, Dr. Brinita Kumari. So anyway, we move ahead. These are the technological issues, you know. I was expecting, and these we are practicing too. And who are the other people available for the presentation? Can they tell me, Shed? Another paper is
by Amle.
You are Amle.
Huh. Sir, can I share?
But I think everything was totally disturbed because of this.
I am trying.
Just listen, we'll give you a chance. Anybody else is available? Anybody else is available for a presentation in this session?
Yes, sir.
Just speak out.
Myself, Dr. Varinder Singh.
Who is there? Doctor?
Varinder Singh.
Dr. Varinder Singh, okay. Varinder Singh, right? Okay. Who else is available?
Pardon?
Hello?
Anybody else is available?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I'm also.
Cut off. Let me just see. Who is that?
Sir, Dr. Gaganpreet.
Dr. Gaganpreet.
Department of Economics and Sociology.
Okay. Right. And who else?
Jagriti.
Jagriti Das, she is also available. Then?
Palak Talwar,
yes. Then? We have more two paper listed. Veer Sam, KK Kundu or Rajkumar. Anybody is available out of these three? No. Then another paper is Amrita Jangale and R.B. Hille. Anyone is available for presentation? No. Okay. So we have only five paper now for the presentation. Hello. So I give another chance to Dr. Amale to continue with the presentation, but I just I request that be brief. You know, I know that there are so many problems with regard to data and all these things. So don't go slide by slide giving all the objective one by one. Just give an overall objective, overall methodology, and your
Hello.
Results.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Hello. Sir, I am going to give my presentation orally only. Yeah?
No, what's your name? What's your name?
Dr. Veer. Dr. Veer Sen. Dr. Veer Sen.
Dr. Veer Sen.
Veer Sen. Veer Sen.
So you are available. I was calling
you.
You are not.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. To wait, I'll give you a first of all. Okay.
Yes, yes, sir. I am orally give my presentation.
Yeah, okay. Start.
Uh-huh. I have used XNT and X-Post approach to evaluate the impact of this soil and water conservation work named as the Jalyukt Shivar Abhiyan. The before year is 2014-15 and after year are the 17-18-19 and 19-20. Results are likewise. There are 28 type of works executed in this program, which are the combination of the soil as well as the water conservation, rain harvesting structure on private as well as the public sector. And near about 95% of the total target has been completed, and minimum target has been completed in case of minor irrigation tank repairing, and 10% of the target work has been completed in case of the Vandrai Bandara at the state level. In case that is the village Ghatshira, there are different 8 type of work has been completed. These are the some photographs. Okay. Now the change in land use due to the execution of the soil and water conservation work in this village. Fallow land does not have changed, while the irrigated area has been increased by near about 23%, with the dip in unirrigated area by the 40%. And the problem, cereals has been decreased by near about 30%, pulses and fodder crops has been decreased by 23% and 16% respectively, while the cash tables and fruit crops has been increased by 52%, 250% respectively. Here the fruit crops are newly introduced in this area due to only the soil water conservation work, like the farm pond on the private farm of the farmer. And therefore the gross crop area is also increased by 1.33. 150 to the 175% due to the availability of the water for the livestock and the fodder crops of like the sugarcane, jawar, maka. Livestock composition has been changed here, where the negative change is seen in case of the bullocks, which are decreased by near about 42%, while the crossbred cows and buffaloes are increased by 28% and 9%. And therefore, the notable observation is that total cattle has been decreased by near about 11%, but the crossbred cows are increased by 30%. And therefore, milk yield increased by 14%. Change in resource use and the productivity of the major crops. Here, due to the availability of the...
I just request that accept the speaker everybody.
By 7%, and the newly introduced crop, that is the fruit crop pomegranate, its the productivity is also increased by only 7%. How the employment pattern has been changed due to the different soil and water conservation work in this village, the labor requirement for the crop production has been increased by 38% in case of the male, while the livestock and wage earning also increased by in case of the male, and in case of female also the for the crop production the employment is increased by 27%, and in case of the livestock employment for the female is increased by 7.42%. Now the income and expenditure pattern. Due to availability of the extra water for the cash crops and fruit crops as well as vegetable crops and rearing of the crossbred cows, the crop production income has been increased by 66%, where the income of per farm has been from 67,000 to the 1,11,000, while the income from the livestock also increased from the 20,000 to the 28,000, and likewise the total of the farmer has been increased by 52%. Now if you see the socio-economic status of the farmers, the farm assets, machinery and building, the picture is changed like this. Number of tractors has been increased by 75%, while the use of drip irrigation system increased by 98%, and the number of pakka house, onion storage structure, livestock shed, these buildings are also increased near about 75 to 140% on the sample farm, and the number of machinery has been increased also on the sample farm. The sample beneficiary farmer also give some suggestions to improvement of this project, like mud education, deepening of the minor irrigation tank, repairing of the chain cement nala burns, continuous contour trenches on the adjacent hilly area, as well as the well and borewell recharge on the large scale. Now we have
to please hurry up in 1 minute, just conclude, please.
Yes, sir. Now I am on the conclusion,
sir. We cannot afford very
irrigated area
on this technology.
Yes.
Just give your message. Give your message that how this conservation has improved our sustainability.
Due to execution of the soil and water conservation work under one umbrella, the execution and the implementation of the scheme is very well, and therefore the irrigated area, fruit crops, vegetable crops, cash crops area is also increased, and therefore the income as well as the employment of the farmer has been increased, and therefore it is necessary to enlarge or extend this scheme on all possible sites in the scarcity zone of the Maharashtra. Thank you, sir.
That's good. That's the message. That's the message that how this conservation help. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
And now I switch on to the next speaker, Veer Sen, and the topic he'll be speaking, studies on the price analysis and forecasting of gram crop in Bhiwani districts of Haryana. But I just request, just in 5 minutes, I know the limitation of this technology. Many of you will run off the data, many of you will be run off the, so many issues. So just give your message in 5 minutes, Dr. Sri, Dr. Sen.
Okay, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, my topic is study on the price analysis and forecasting of gram crop in Bhiwani district of Haryana.
Yeah.
And the study is based on the primary as well as secondary data and marketing information system is an interacting the structure of people, equipment, and procedure to arrange, analyze, evaluate, and distributing timely and right information for use of proper marketing decision to make improve their marketing design and implementation and control. The marketing system is the creating and distributing, the promoting and the selling the goods and services and the idea to make easy, satisfying relationship with customer in the lively environment. And during the study, my objective was to estimate the price forecast and long-term relationship in price among the domestic market. And in B1 district, I have selected the four market. First one is Shivani, Charkhidadri, Tosam, and Bhiwani. And each market, 20 traders were selected during these market. And and for analysis, the ARIMA model was used during this study, and it was based on the forecasting purpose. And the study was taken in 2005 to 2016, which were used forecasting future value using ARIMA model. And the ARIMA modeling is also called as the box-janking methodology. And the box-janking procedure is concerned with fitting a mixed portfolio moving average model to given a set of data. And the main objective in fitting this ARIMA model is to identify the stochastic process of time series and predicate the future value accurately. And these methods have been useful in many types of situations and which involve the building of model for discrete time series and dynamic system. The main step in the ARIMA modeling is have the four step. First one is identification, second one is estimation, third one is diagnostic check, and last one is forecasting. In identification, we check the value of ARIMA model like as AR, IMA, means autoregressive integrated moving average. If AR is 0 and 1, then it is the stationary or significant relief. And if I is... Hello?
If
I value is non-stationary, then we make the stationary value, and the value is 0 and 1, then it is the stationary. If the value is more than 1, like as 2, 3, then this is the non-stationary. And if the value is set and the ARIMA modeling is flawed, then forecasting, and if the non-stationary, then again we run the model in SPSS for using the ARIMA modeling. And the result and discussion, during this market, like as Shivani, Dadri, and Tosam, and Bhiwani, and the Dadri district is the maximum benefits for a trader because the RMPS, MA, and NBIC are very low. Because if the RMPS, MA, and BIC is very high, then they have the non-stationary or non-significant relief. And the modeling is based on using the auto correlation coefficient and partial auto correlation coefficient. If the value is 0, 1, 1, and
please,
0,
please
1.
Please are going to the methodology. Please listen.
Yes, that's it. Result and discussion. Result and discussion,
simply,
sir.
I just want to know your full paper
is with everyone.
Those who are interested, they will read your full paper.
Okay, sir.
What do you think? What are the forecasting with regard to price and production as per your model?
Okay, sir. And the four districts, the Bhiwani, Dadri, Tosam, and Shivani. And the main benefits are found in the Dadri district because the farmer and trader, as well as they get the maximum use of information according to their NIAM, National Agriculture Market, and other agriculture department schemes. And the better result in the Dadri district and
is it over?
Have you finished?
Is the presentation over?
I think
Hello.
Is it over? Hello.
Mr. Veer Sen.
Hello.
Hello, we are listening.
Are you able to hear us?
Yes, sir.
Your presentation over?
Yes, sir. Almostly.
You want to say something more or is almost finished?
Yeah, sir.
Finished.
Okay. So,
sir, can you ask me one question?
Yeah, sir.
Okay, you can.
Sir, should I ask you one question?
Yeah, sure.
So actually, I want to ask you, Mr. Veer Sen, you have gone for forecasting of gram. So what was the impact on the area under gram crop? For example, you have given for forecasting in advance that this much would be the price of gram in the next, in the future, we can say. Huh?
Yes, sir.
What was the impact on area under gram? Whether it was beneficial for the farmers or not? Have you done that part of the study or not?
Yes, sir. It is very feasible for the farmer because the areas depend on the infrared saturation and the environment that is very useful.
I want to ask, what was your forecast price at what the farmers got? That is my question.
Farmer got the remaining price, sir, according to cost.
Okay. Anybody else want to have immediate query? Okay, Dr. Jain, should we proceed?
Okay. Yeah, sure. I actually wanted to ask him this question, but I think he is not able to tell what I want to ask him. This type of study is important in the sense if it is beneficial for the farmer. If we are going for any ARIMA model or any other model, getting some results and there is no use for the farmers, then what is the use for this type of studies?
Okay, yeah, that's right. And Dr. Jain, we just keep this point for the last. We will just devote 10-15 minutes. There we can discuss this point, right?
Okay, sir. Okay.
Hello? So now we can proceed with the next paper. Actually, next paper I'm once again announcing. It is by Amruta Jagale and R.B. Hille, but none of them available. So keeping them in view, their absence. I'm moving forward, and now I invite Jagruti Das for the presentation on rural Indian dairy sector and women empowerment, truth or fallacy. So, yes, Jagruti Das, are you ready?
Yes, sir, I am.
Okay, and the same story is with you also, just 5 to 7 minutes maximum, 5 to 7 minutes maximum.
Yes,
and, sir. I also request those who are not speaking, they should keep their mic off. Dr. Shalini, you keep your mic off.
Can I start, sir?
Yeah, you can start. Dr. Shalini, are you listening to me? Okay, anyway, you start.
Hello, everyone. I'm Jagruti Das. I'm going to present on my research article on behalf of myself and Anita Horo and Dr. Ajmeer Singh. And the topic is rural Indian dairy sector and women farming, truth or fallacy. Agriculture is the major in the rural population, but these days we see a very clear trend in agriculture, which is that it's become feminized. The feminization of dairy sector has started long back. Hello. Yes, sir. Let me share the screen again. But feminization of dairy sector has started just after Operation Flood. We can see that about 70% of the worker, 80% of food processors are women with respect to dairy sector. In dairy sector, majorly, the status of farming is given to men rather than women, and the women do most work with grazing for a long time. And but when it comes to decisions like marketing or monetary decisions, mostly to men. Women are not given as most important in that sector.
Hello, Dr. Jain, you want to say something?
Hello.
Jagruti, you continue, please.
Yes. For this paper, what I have done is basically a debut study which I have collected from various secondary sources, which includes Indian Labour Bureau reports, different rounds of NSSO data, FAO reports, where reports and newspaper articles. And coming to the result and discussion, here we see the age-wise distribution of rural female labor force participation per thousand as per youth status compared to different rounds of NSSO. And we can see that we can observe both trends, like feminization as well as defeminization of Indian labor force. Defeminization is which is occurred in urban areas, whereas feminization is mostly occurred in the rural sector. We see the female labor force, and the rural female labor force has been reduced to half the rural female labor force as per the ELCO report. And availability of women, we see that what kind of work women find easy while doing in the household. We can see that women don't report themselves as unemployed if they have some free time left. And according to this data, which I'm sharing now, it is mostly seen that the type of acceptable work, whether it is full time or part time, is mostly paid.
Jagruti, sometimes you are audible, sometimes you don't. I think that you need to reset your mic.
Am I audible now, sir?
Yeah, but sometimes you're audible, sometimes you don't. I think keep your mic in just front of your mouth.
Okay, sir. So, as we see that the type of work is accepted by women they're willing to accept at the household premises, we see that be it full-time or part-time, the kind of work they are able to accept is mostly dairy, poultry, or other animal husbandry work, other than tailoring and others. So here we could find that dairying could be one of the important activities in order to engage women as well to involve their self-life and increase their self-life status. While coming to my next slide.
Hello.
Am I audible?
You just speak.
Okay, sir. I'll just speak. There's one more trend we've seen in the Indian dairy sector. It is that rural Indian women work for far more hours than the average rural Indian male, but they are less self-reliant and there's an increased dependency, hindering the empowerment at the household level itself. The constraints in accessing resources, they have these resources, financial services or market opportunity, which also affect the decision making and it prevents the women from reaching the potential. And according to a study, it has seen that women constitute more than 50% of labor force that's involved in livestock sector. And this
Thank you.
and according to social being male and female agriculture, non-agriculture, instead of female agriculture is far below than that of male non-agriculture.
Jagriti, have yes, you sir? Off your video? We are not able to see you. Your video is off. Neither we are seeing your data nor with your face. We are just looking at J only. Hello. Hello, Jagriti. Are you there, Jagriti?
Hello.
Yes, sir,
I am there.
We are not seeing your face, neither the data you share. So better you on your video.
Sir, I switched it on.
But still you are not, we are not able to look at you. No, your video is not on. But anyway, you just finish your, just share your conclusion with us, no?
So we conclude that despite the significant involvement in participation, inequalities exist in Indian villages.
Yes.
Support of women by owners and professors.
You're not audible.
Hello. Yes, sir. Am I audible now?
Yeah, but you just simply share your conclusion, no, please.
Yes, sir. Despite the significant involvement and participation, gender biasness often in the villages and needs to be correct, recognized and supported. Women's role in livestock as livestock owners and processors needs to be supported and recognized. And dairy as an enterprise needs to be promoted in order to empower women. And policies should be made accordingly, which would help. There should be more women-centric in order to help them. Thank you.
What kind of policies you suggest in this regard to make women more empowered through this dairy sector? What government should do? Hello?
Women in especially in relation to marketing and ownership of livestock assets. So, I mean, maybe they, women should be provided with more subsidies or such. Or the SFG linkage should be strengthened in order to help women with marketing of their produce. And when we come to the processing sector, the women's role as processors should be one of the areas where policy leaders should focus their policies upon.
Okay, thank you very much for your presentation. Anybody have some query? Immediate query. Anybody has any question? Dr. Jain Singh, you want to ask?
No, sir, actually, I was not able to hear anything.
Yeah, she was not audible.
Screen sharing was also not there.
I couldn't see her face also. And sometimes she was audible, sometimes she was not audible.
I thought that mic was
wavering. So anyway, thank you very much. And now we move to the next presentation, And this presentation is by Varinder Singh Sandy. And the presentation title is An Assessment of Livelihood Security Based on Biogas Plants in Selected Villages of District Patiala of Punjab. So Varinder, just your full paper is already with everyone. Those will be interested, they will read it out. Just in 5 minutes, just tell us the message that what your study brings out. Dr. Varinder Sandy, you can start.
Not audible, sir.
Please start speaking. Dr. Varinder, do you hear me? Dr. Varinder, do you hear me? Do you hear me? Just speak out.
Hello.
Yes, speak out. Just speak out, Varinder Singh.
Hello. Okay. Okay, my today's paper is an assessment of livelihood security based on some biogas plants in different districts of Patiala, district of Punjab, different villages. So we have planned a study to take out some based on survey to get different views about the users of biogas plants as based on the just a few basic introduction. So sustainability, sustaining livelihood in today's world is in terms of quality of life, better living, economic growth, employment and production needs supply of energy. So biogas plant in turn supply some sort of energy to the rural villages. So based on the biogas plant, a study was conducted at different villages. So to collect the information related to the farmland holding, biogas plant installed, and in this survey work, so we have already included some farmers who are not having biogas plants also. And the size of biogas plant at their level, the year of installation, number of cattle heads, type of fuel used, and usage of biogas plant for other purposes or for kitchen purposes. Also, socio-economic considerations or factors were also involved in the survey work by knowing the household income from different sources, data on cultivable area was also collected. And difference between the livelihood of the users that are having biogas plant and users and the farmers that are not having biogas plant were also compared. And also the impact of the biogas plant on their livelihood is also analyzed, and also the most most important impact of the biogas plants is the containment of greenhouse gases. They reduce the greenhouse gases that would have been emitted if the cattle dung is being disposed of in open. So total data was collected from the 45 farming families, 15 villages of district Patiala. The most prominent villages were the Narayangarh, Gullar, Sagda, Kular, and so on. So a total of 45 farmers were surveyed, out of that 31 farmers were having biogas plants at domestic level, and out of that 28 plants were found in working conditions. So whereas the biogas plant, the type of biogas plant was the Deen Bandhu, and most common size of the biogas plant was 6 meter cube, and the some of the most of the users of the biogas plant uses for their kitchen purposes, for cooking, for daily cooking purposes. And it was also found that the 12 farmers were also making tung cakes for using at the chula for their optional purposes. So based on the survey, a data was collected on the strength of the family members, land they are holding, their overall income from different sources. So it was found that the average family members were 5, and there, out of 45 household surveys, 13 were found with income from the government or private sector. It was also found that 7 farmers were running some own business. So the overall.
Dr. Varinder Sahi, if may disturb you, please just let us know the impact of this biogas plant on the livelihood and all those characteristics. Everybody has your full district paper, they can read it. Just let us know what is the sustainable issue for those people on their livelihood, those who have biogas plants.
Okay, so I'm coming to that. So this is the cost spent on the livelihood by the people having biogas plant, and there is considerable amount of savings done by biogas plant users based on the wood LPG cylinders. So you can see, we can see saved by the biogas plant users. So overall, the annual cost of livelihood was of the biogas plant come out to be 1,67,911. So whereas the livelihood of the people having not having biogas plant was considerably higher at 1,83,520, because of the they cannot save the fuel wood on fuel on wood or LPG cylinders. So averagely, the biogas plant user saved about 9 LPG cylinders yearly. So impact of biogas, so the thing made by the biogas plant by using the in the field. So it was found that the dried slurry as a manure was used on an averagely about 5 acres. So means the money spent by the non-biogas plant users was considerably higher than the biogas plant users. So on an average, the average money saved by the biogas plant users by employing only the manure was about 4,000 per acre.
So this is the whole message.
Savings made by the us do not have fire because they are already have and it can use as FIM instead of biogas. Okay, so most important aspect is the greenhouse gas emission. Huge amount of greenhouse gases of biogas plant as compared to the non-users of biogas plants, because they are disposing of the dung in the open. So about 1 ton of methane has been captured within the biogas plant. Otherwise, that could have been contributed towards the greenhouse gases. And the ammonia was 751 kg.
Right.
Is it over?
Is it over, Sandy? Dr. Sandy, is it over now? Your presentation is over?
Hello.
Greenhouse emission. Yes, there is a huge amount of
use. Are you telling me to start the presentation?
Yes, I'm getting back.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Dr.
Okay, Sandy. There is a benefit of the.
Yes, we have got your message. Hello.
Yes,
Dr. Sambi, we have got your message. And my simple query is: have you calculated the cost benefit analysis of this biogas plant?
The cost benefit is only the sustainability issue.
You said that it also reduced the cost of production. It increased the real income of the farmer because they have to spend less on fuel and other things. So that gives a more income to the farmer also.
Yes, but it was found from the study that the usage of slurry of the biogas plant as compared to the farmyard manure made by the cattle dung, that were not significant. There was not significant difference between that.
Okay.
So the actual usage of the biogas plants is mainly in the fuel saving in the kitchen, as well as the greenhouse gas reduction.
Right.
So that was the most important one.
That's right. So thank you very much for your presentation. Anybody else has some query, some question?
So I want to ask him one question, that whether if the farmers who have the biogas plant, they were using slurry only in their fields, not urea, DAP, water fertilizers?
Hello?
Was also used in addition to that. So there was
then how we can say that it's just only effect of slurry only? So when we are at the same time, we are also using urea, DAP. We can see, for example, a farmer who is not having any biogas plant, he may be using farmyard manure also. Then what is the difference? Then how we can say that beneficial in terms of, we can say we are just saving on LPG only, or yes, we are getting good, we can say slurry, that is good farmyard manure converted into slurry.
Yes,
cannot say that just biogas, they are adding more to their is because of livelihood.
No.
So there are so many factors also.
Study has not said that the biogas is improving the production, but biogas is helping in the energy reduction of the household.
Yeah, that is true.
Only, and also the biogas employs in the reduction of the gases.
Yeah, that ammonia and methane, the reduction is there.
Yes.
That is more important. That's most important. In the present world, when we say sustainability improves,
yes,
the lifestyle. Yeah, that's right. So it's good to have this biogas plants. Those who can afford, they should go for it. This is a win-win situation. So thank you very much, Dr. Sandy, for your presentation. Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Now we switch on to the next presentation, that is social media uses among rural youth in Ludhiana district of Punjab. And the presenter is Gaganpreet Kaur.
Hello,
Gagan.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. You start with the presentation?
Yes, sir. Today's my presentation is on the topic social media usage among rural youth in the Ludhiana district of Punjab. The communication is a vital part of regular daily existence, and the nature has nourished only the human beings with the supremacy of communication. Social media has been playing an important role for communicating with each and every individual around the world. And so the social media facilitates of communication, texting, sharing of images, video and audio sharing, quick publishing, direct connection, and joining with people living all over the globe. So the social networking sites are termed as web-based services that give opportunities to the individuals to create their profiles with the choices of their interests. Social media networking tools like Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and WhatsApp have facilitated creation and exchange of ideas too quickly. Then the youth, being vibrant, dynamic, innovative, and enthusiastic in nature, is the most powerful section of the population. And this category of population is most receptive to the changes. It means their ideas, views, and patterns of behavior are expected to change in response to the unleashed new forces by social media, education, internet, and information technology, etc. About 100 million are using social media. And with all its obvious advantages, social media sites have several limitations also, which if not intervened, would turn into hazardous problems. Realizing the problems of addiction to the social media is rampant, several medical institutions and NGOs have come up with de-addiction centers, which offer pragmatic measures to consumers, users, de-addicted for media usage. So like a coin, with the two sides, social media has both advantages and disadvantages. And for this, the study is an effort with the specific objectives of examining the patterns and purposes of social media usage among rural youth. As far as with the methodology is concerned, the study was conducted in rural areas of Ludhiana district of Punjab, and simple random sampling technique was used to select the sample respondents. At the first stage, two blocks were selected, and at the second stage, three villages from each block, total six villages were selected, and further 25 rural youth respondents of 35 years of age, consisting 150 respondents in all, were selected, and the data was used by analyzing into percentages, ranking, mean scores, and DMRT tests. The results, as far as the results and discussions, the study found that half, that is 47.3% of the youth, spend up to 4 hours on the social media on working days, and more than half spend more, up to 8 hours also during weekends on social media. YouTube was ranked as first and was the most sought, whereas WhatsApp ranking 2, then the Facebook at rank 3, and TikTok was ranked at 4th during working days, while in the weekends, TikTok and Instagram were on 3rd and 4th rank during the weekends. Regarding the purposes of the social media, it was seen that different users and of the different apps were used for different purposes, and the rural youth used WhatsApp for chatting as well as calling. That was 81% of the respondents, while YouTube was used for watching videos. That was 78%, and Facebook 48%, and Instagram 14.7% were preferred for the entertainment. Then social media was perceived as a major source of knowledge at rank 1, followed by the source of entertainment, rank 2, and providing learning opportunities, rank 3. Along with the positive sides, there was some negative sides also. The rural youth felt undue pressure, that was at rank 1, and increased communication gap, rank 2, with family, and the negative impact on education as well as work on ranking 3 were the highest, greatest demerits of the social media. So I come to conclusion and some suggestions also. Social media have taken the world by a storm, leading to nothing less than a revolution. One can easily see the entry gates of these social networking sites, but is unable to find the exit gate for these sites. Rural youth spend more time on unproductive things like chatting, calling, watching videos, resulting in absenteeism from work as well as education. So the study suggested that digital holiday and a digital detox as a measure to lessen the pressure of social media. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Very, very interesting topic. And I think
thank you, sir. Thank you.
The data pertain to this period.
The study was done recently in 2019 and 20.
No, recently,
the data was collected in 2000. No, sir. It finished in January 2020, and the data was collected 2019.
Well before the lockdown started.
Yes.
And,
yes, sir.
what you can expect, you know, what you,
otherwise,
you think during the lockdown, how you think would have changed? Just your perception.
During the lockdown period, Doctor, then Zoom and other such sites might have came up as a use amongst the youth. So study was well completed before the lockdown. That's why the other sites, that is YouTube, Facebook, and WhatsApp, prominently came up. But of course, nowadays we are realizing the importance of these other sites, which are say helping us well connected, and we are going through this tough phase with the help of all such sites, Zoom. Positive side is coming more nowadays.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, because when she said that the knowledge gaining rank one, so that is very important. Yes. That now the youth is involved in the social media.
Virtual kind of
them to get more and more information and knowledge.
Yeah, very right.
That is a very positive sign of this social media.
Yeah, very right.
Up till now, we just see social media from its negative angle. But now we are also looking it at the positive angle. So very, very good presentation. And anybody has any question? This is a very interesting topic. Dr. Jayam Singh, and anybody else?
Sir, ma'am, I want to ask you that actually, I want to add that from my point of view, this social media for rural youth, that is not, I think, they are not using in a productive way. Rather, what my opinion, because I also belong to rural area.
The same thing.
So there I want to say that they are misusing it, I think, as compared to they are using it in a good way. Although it can be good for people who are using we are doing some academic work. But for most people, they are going for this YouTube and they are going for some, you know, all this. So for rural youth, I'd say it's not so.
Dr. JM, your observations are quite pertinent, and our study also has come up with the same kind of findings, that rural youth are unnecessarily spending much more time on these sites, and that is what they are causing absenteeism from their work as well as education. Yeah,
this is sure, madam, because they are spending more on TikTok.
This is what is shared during these slides also, that during the weekends, the time spent by youth, especially on TikTok, which came out to be third in that rank, they spend more than 8 hours on the weekends. And that is what we concluded, that this is causing more absenteeism. And we needed such kind of detox and digital de-addictions sort of program. This is what our study came up with. And your observations are very right and very pertinent, especially in case of rural youth. And our study was concentrated to rural youth only.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shalini, for making all the clarifications. So it was a good and very interesting presentation. And now I invite the last speaker of the day, is Pallak Talwar, and the topic she will speak on is attitude and adoption of agri-retailing by farmers in Punjab.
Hello, good afternoon everyone. I'm delighted to be part of this webinar. Am I audible to everyone?
If you can still improve a little, I don't know.
Am I audible now?
Yeah, you are. Palak, you are audible.
Thank you. Here I start my presentation on attitude and adoption of agri-retailing by farmers in Punjab. Agri-retailing is basically sale and purchase of goods directly to final consumers, agriculture farmers. My present study was conducted to study the attitude of farmers toward agri-retailing and extent of adoption and problem faced by them, mainly in three regions, Majwa, Malwa, and Doaba. We took 60 farmers, and a total of 180 farmers were surveyed. The results showed that a farmer purchased mainly seeds, pesticides, fertilizers and agri implements. As we all know that India has an extensive sales and distribution network, we know that a study is required for the agriculture input consumer behavior. So we require to discuss in detail what is the attitude and adoption of agri-retailing by farmers. One problem we came through is that there was less shelf space and no room for new products when we go through agri-retailing. To fulfill the objective of my research, we go through the primary data which was collected through a structured non-disguised schedule. After collection of data, master tables were constructed through analysis of data like percentage, ranking, and analysis of variance. In results and discussion, first, my objective was to see what was the socioeconomic profile of farmers. Mostly farmers were between the age 26 to 40 who were using agri-retailing. Their education qualification was matriculation. Their annual age income was mostly of 1,50,000 to 5 lakhs. Their annual farm income was from 1 lakh to 3 lakh, and their land holding was medium land holding. They got awareness mainly from Haryali Kisan Bazaar, that is 95 respondents said that they are mostly aware about Haryali Kisan Bazaar rather than Tata Kisan Sansar. The sources of information of their agri-retail was mainly from relatives and friends and least from TV and radio. The annual expenditure of purchase of agri-input mostly was on seed, that is mostly 107 respondents said that they mostly purchase seeds from agri-retail shops. Then attitude and adoption of selling agriculture produce to agri-retail farmers. They might they usually feel comfortable about purchasing from agri-retailers. Products sold to organized agri-retail outlets mostly are from they buy seeds from them. Important factors while selling agri-produce to the organized retailers. The most important factors which was considered was price of the agri-produce and less on the display within the output. So they are not considered about the display, but they are find that from where they can get the get product at least price. Level of satisfaction was the convenience of purchase. And now we can go through the problem faced by farmers while purchasing inputs and selling agri-produce to agri-retail outputs. Respondents feel that they have problem on less field visits by experts, problem of late home delivery, high price of agri-inputs, non-availability of products are stored at different prices. While selling the agri-produce, the farmer faced problems of time consumer documentation, lesser transportation availability. Recommendation to other farmers for adoption of agri-retailing and reasons for recommendation. Mostly, all the farmers said that they will recommend agri-retailing to other farmers, and the reasons for the recommendation are quick payment, price, convenience of selling, transportation availability, suitable timing, attractiveness of outlet, and location of outlet. So I conclude that the study with the preference factors for establishing organized agri-retail outlets, retailers are mostly considering the transportation facility near the store. Hence, they get timely availability of the product. They get product at a fair price, and the product are easily stored near to the usage of the product. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Paula Talwa, for making the presentation. And this is like the platform where we can discuss from the uses of social media. And then just going to agri-retail marketing. Sometimes we are going on sustainability. So very wide issues and very nice presentation. And if you know, we can have some time for discussion, including on you. So let me tell you that for this session, 11 papers were scheduled for your presentation. And I'm extremely happy to announce that out of 11, 10 papers to record, 10 papers have been presented here with all the details, with everything, and all were very, very nice presentation. So now we can have some 5 to 7, because mostly we have discussed the paper immediately after the presentation, but still right now if some audience, some participant, they need to ask some question, so we can just discuss that topic for 5 to 7 minutes before we close this. So now it's open for discussion. Any question can be asked to any presenter. Any question? Anybody want to ask?
Sir,
I think at the end of each presentation, we had interaction regarding that paper.
We have done. That is why I'm just keeping 5 to 7 minutes only.
Yeah.
If some people, they have not asked any question, if they think that it was in my mind, because now after 5 to 7 minutes, we are going to conclude it. And if anybody has any query, I'm just giving a second chance.
Otherwise, we can thank Dr. Grover and Dr. J.M. Singh to chair and co-chair the sessions in such a compulsive kind of situation and giving us the opportunity to...
Dr. Grover, that's all?
Yeah.
Mr. Amle is there?
Dr. Amle is there?
Amle, who was having a presentation on soil water conservation actually?
I think he is not here.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Amle, are you there? No, he's not there.
I think he's left.
So yeah, actually, that is why at that time I wanted to ask you a question related to you, that how this, just because we can say that they have more harvesting structures available, that it resulted in an increase in each and everything. Cash crops, yield increase, food crops, yield increase, gross coverage increase, crop intensity increase, crossbred crops, buffaloes increased. So just because of this only water consumption, so how that was possible? I just wanted to ask you.
Right, but I think that speaker is not. And perhaps, perhaps that was the only idea in my mind, that we can ask the topic, we can discuss the topic immediately after the presentation.
It should be actually asked immediately after that paper, because sometimes we also forget that. It's not there to answer all this.
Yeah, but we did like that only. Immediately after the every presentation, we had a good number of questions.
We didn't ask any other
queries from any other speaker? Any other query from any other speaker, Dr. J.M. Singh?
Sir, no, sir. I have no query. I have asked, I think, questions to each and everyone. And I'm also running short of my battery, phone battery.
I knew it. That is why I was asking every presenter to be little...
Just 32% left.
Oh, that is too much. 32% is too much. Then we can have... if there is no more question, and I think that we have discussed most of the things. And I once again thank you very much, all the participants, and for their intellectual talk. And they were all well prepared for their presentation here. Very, very nice presentation. So with this, I think we can conclude this session. And whatever we spoke, it is all, everything is being recorded. And if somebody has not have any other queries, everything is in the record right now. So with this, I thank once again all the participants for their excellent talk, and Dr. J.M. Singh for pure chairing and giving good time for discussion. I'm also very, very thankful to Dr. Surbhi Bansal. I think she has kept a good record of the major points which have emerged out of this discussion as a repetitive. So one and all, thank you once again. Okay, bye-bye. And now we will assemble again at 2 o'clock for validating session. Thank you very much. Have a nice time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Heartily welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.